If I look at the foot, when we think about the foot, we've got to think about the arches of the foot. They're what we're really interested in, aren't they? And so we have a medial arch, we have a lateral arch, and we have a transverse arch. And the transverse arch, you can think about, we talk about it as one arch, but there's kind of three sections to it, really. There's the section at the metatarsal heads, there's the section at the anterior part of the tarsal bones, and then there's like the roof of the arch, which is the more dome-shaped part, which is the middle of the tarsal bones, okay? So that's, in the McKeown paper, that's where they talk about the functional foot dome. So those are the areas we're interested in. In terms of the medial arch, then we're thinking about the first metatarsal and its connection into the medial cuneiform, and the connection to the medial cuneiform to the navicula, onto the talus, onto the calcaneus. Okay, that's what's going to form that arch. What's really important about the medial arch is actually the strength of the plantar fascia. And when we look at locomotion, module 3, the importance of the windlass mechanism to locomotion. The lateral arch, fifth metatarsal to the cuboid, onto the calcaneus, and at the top end of the calcaneus there's an articulation with the talus, because the talus sits on top of it. Alright? So if you think about the foot, we have to think about the first metatarsal head, the fifth metatarsal head, and the calcaneus. And we've got this triangular shape. Yeah? And when we hit the floor, the forces as you hit are transmitted backwards towards into the calcaneus, forwards towards the lateral border, across to the first metatarsal and between the first and second metatarsal, and then on through the first toe. Right? So our forces take this kind of zigzag approach. Yeah? And that's really important because the medial arch then got a strong plantar fascia and a strong ligamentous support there, means that as the forces are transmitted that way, we have a kind of rebound effect in terms of our energy coming back. So if we think about it, it's coming back, but it's really coming back, but up. So it's that energy, that recoil, if you like, from the force of us landing that actually comes up through the body. So the support of the arch system helps us stay up. Yeah, that gives us our spring, if you like, some of the springiness. The medial arch particularly acts like a truss. Yeah, you know, a truss that's supporting a roof. With the weight of the roof coming down, you set the building so that it holds you up. That's through the ligaments, but also through the interosseous muscle activity. And it's helped by the action of your peronei, or fibularis if you read American texts, and tib post. So those two, peroneus longus and tib post, act and they come underneath and kind of help support the arches. So we think about those muscles, and remember we're thinking of muscle activity, your inverters are much stronger in normality than your everters. If your everters have weakened because they've been held in a lengthened position, that's going to make it even more difficult. So some of the biases we see in our patients, if you think of the natural, forget any neurology, if you think of the natural resting position of the foot, it's a triplanar joint, the ankle joint. It's not a straight hinge. So you will always get an element of inversion or supination, with plantar flexion. So when you are resting in bed, your feet will drop into this position. If you can't move, then the weight of the covers will also just do that to you, and your foot will then adopt that more supinated and plantar flexed position. That's going to keep lengthening here, and we know from yesterday's lecture that makes long, weak muscles, and this makes short, tight muscles if I'm in a shortened position. So if there was nothing else wrong with the patient and we were inactive here, we have the potential potential to develop a problem. The state of feet and ankles is actually something